Welcome to this teaching video from Stroke and Neurovascular Interventions Foundation. In this video, we are going to talk about timing of carotid artery revascularization. That means in patients with carotid artery stenosis, when should we do carotid artery stenting? There are two settings in which we do carotid stenting. Number one, patient who has a previous TIE or stroke and we want to do stenting to prevent further events. And secondly, in terms of acute stroke settings, when an embolus has gone and occluded distal vessel, we take out the clot as well as we want to do carotid artery revascularization. So what are the indications which are there in the guidelines? So in patient with a proven symptoms, a symptomatic stenosis, more than 70%, if the risk is less than 6%, we should go ahead. More than 50% not considered to be acceptable, provided your risk is less than 3%. In asymptomatic stenosis, more than 60%, if the risk is less than 3%, we can do stenting. However, usually we like to do an asymptomatic stenosis when the stenosis is more than 80% or so. And how does carotid artery stenosis causes symptoms? There is a plaque which is deposited there, and then the plaque ruptures and small emboli go from the plaque. But sometimes a big embolus can go from the plaque and occlude endocrine artery to cause a stroke. And for further progression, there's a clot forms over the plaque and occludes the artery completely, the main carotid artery. Now coming to the setting of transient ischemic attack, now meta-analysis which has been published, it has been shown that the risk of stroke at 2, 30 and 90 days is 9.9, 13.4 and 17.3%. That means the risk is very high within first few weeks itself. And the graph shows this very well, the risk of stroke after a TIA. One can see how in the initial period, the risk of stroke is very high. The ABCD3 and ABCD3I scores, which predict the risk of stroke after a TIA, in that scoring as well, patient who has got dual TIAs, that means multiple TIAs after a event. Secondly, patient who have more than 50% IC stenosis. And when the imaging in DWI shows positivity, we know these kind of patients have got a higher incidence of stroke within first 2 weeks. So when should we do it in TIA or minor stroke? The higher risk of stroke in within first 2 weeks means, particularly patient which has got DWI lesions and arterial stenosis, we should do early revascularization. At least within first 2 weeks, we like to do as soon as possible. Just to show you a typical case, this is an old lady and she came with a TIA. The MRI shows DWI positivity, some small white spots in this MRI lesions. The CT angle shows a tight stenosis of the ICA, which was confirmed on DSA. So this is a typical patient, high risk of stroke within first 2 weeks. We went ahead and did a stenting in the acute setting. Another patient had came with a stroke. CT scan looked normal. Perfusion imaging showed a small perfusion deficit. Patient was given IV tPA. Patient improved completely. The CT angio again showed severe ICA stenosis, DWI lesion shows positivity, small patchy infarctions. This patient had recurrent TIA within the same admission. So in an emergency setting, we went ahead and performed carotid artery stenting. We showed a severe stenosis, we placed a filter device, then did angioplasty followed by a stent placement, resulting in complete opening of the artery. But sometimes one has to wait, like this patient, who came with a large infarction in the left MCA territory. In such a large infarction, if you open up the artery in acute state, there is a risk of revascularization. CT angio showed a severe stenosis, but we waited in this patient for around 5 weeks. Later on, we did the stenting of the severe stenosis. We performed the stent placement. Another setting where sometimes we may end up waiting is when there is a large clot formation within the artery. Now, this was a young 40-year-old man with history of smoking. The angiogram shows a severe stenosis with a large floating clot. If the clot was small, maybe we could have performed endarterectomy. But with the large floating clot, we waited. The patient put on anticoagulant. Then the angiogram shows complete clearing of the clot and the stenting was performed. Now we come to the setting of carotid revascularization in patient with acute stroke, when we are doing acute stroke mechanical recanalization. So when do we do it? In patient with acute stroke, with carotid occlusion with a high NHSS, a small infarction and presence of penumbra, whichever means we may determine, these are the settings in which we go in for the revascularization. And these kind of patients will have tandem occlusion. That means there's a proximal atherosclerotic stenosis or occlusion and a distal embolus which has gone into the brain circulation. There are various issues we have to consider in these patients. Whether we do proximal to distal or distal to proximal. That means whether we recanalize the proximal or the distal lesion first. Whether we do angioplasty or do a stenting. How do we use the antiplatelet agents in the setting of acute stroke to prevent reperfusion hemorrhage in these patients. Now this is a very critical question because in the clot bust trial what they found that the prognosis of patients with IC occlusions or a tandem occlusions is very poor after IVTPA. And now various trials such as Extend IA, Swift Prime and MR Clean and other trials have proven that the mechanical recanalization is effective in selected group of patients. So how do we do it? In acute stroke patients with IC occlusion, usually we recanalize the distal lesion first. That means we take out the clot in the brain circulation first. We take the guiding catheter across the stenosis, we recanalize the intracranial artery, then we check the proximal ICA. If there is a good flow, not a severe stenosis, we wait, but if it need be, we do angioplasty. If we think angioplasty is not going to keep the artery patent, we place a stent as well. Regarding the drug, if we have given the IVTP to the patients, then we give aspirin 150 mg and clopidogrel 225 mg. Otherwise, we give 300 mg of aspirin and 450 mg of clopidogrel after the stent placement. This is a typical case, 60-year-old female patient with history of hypertension and hypothyroidism, acute onset stroke, no history of seizures, CT brain perfusion done at 6 hours after the ictus, which showed a small infarction in the right frontal region, but there was a big penumbra as well with intracranial occlusion of the MCA and IC occlusion. So we went ahead with recanalization. The DSA showed complete occlusion of the ICA. We crossed it with a wire, took the guiding across, and the guiding catheter injection shows patent ACA but blocked off MCA. So we took a microcatheter into the distal normal artery, deployed the solitaire, and the picture shows that once we have taken out the clot, there's a complete recanalization. In this case, we placed the filter device and did a small angioplasty. The artery looked well patent, so we didn't do the stent placement in acute stage. The CT scan later on shows some dye within the infarcted zone, but the patient did pretty well, recovered almost completely on follow-up. At 2 months follow-up, we can see the severe stenosis, and we went ahead with the stent placement in that period with complete patent intracranial arteries, and you can see the small residual infarction in the right frontal region. While this is a different patient, a different setting, this patient had came with again with severe hemiparesis of left side. We could see the infarct in the right basal ganglia and occlusion of the middle cerebral artery, and the perfusion imaging showed that although there was a basal ganglia infarction, but there was a big area of hyperperfusion in the right MCA territory. The angiogram shows severe stenosis of the ICA with maybe some underlying clot there. In this patient, we thought that we will do the stent first, recanalize the proximal and then the distal. So we placed the filter device, did the stent placement, the clot within the stenosis was caught in the filter device as it could be seen. And then we could see the middle cerebral artery occlusion and we took that clot out with the solitaire stent with complete recanalization. The follow-up MR shows the infarct in the basal ganglia which was there before, but otherwise the MCA territory was normal and patient did pretty well. This is another patient, a 41-year-old male patient. This case is to show that every carotid occlusion is not because of the stenosis. This was a 41-year-old male patient with severe MR and low ejection fraction, had stroke in sleep. When the patient came, you could see the dense MCA sign and a big area of hypoperfusion with infarction in the basal ganglia. There was a big penumbra with occlusion of the ICA, CT angio and intracranial MCA. We did the angiogram, you can see the ICA tapered off, but this was because of the intracranial clot. So we took the guiding catheter in and the injection shows large clot in the ICA and MCA. The microcatheter was crossed across the clot, solitaire was deployed and solitaire was able to take out the clot in two passes. The final angiogram shows complete recanalization of the brain circulation. And now when we take the IC injection, you can see the IC is completely filling. That means it wasn't IC stenosis, it was a collapsed IC because of the distal clot. So in this case, doesn't need any stenting or angioplasty. The CT scan then next day seen contrast in the infarct, but the patient recovered at 90 days to MRS of 0. There's a one paper published from Dr. Puri et al. about when they did proximal recanalization. And in their cases, they load the patient with aspirin, and then we do a cone beam CT scan. If there's no hemorrhage, then only they give loading dose of clopidogrel. Well, there's another paper which actually compared proximal versus distal recanalization. And this is a nice study. And what it clearly showed that in the thrombectomy first, that in the distal clot removal first, the time to recanalization was much less than when they did proximal recanalization. And favorable outcomes were also more common in the thrombectomy first, from 52% in the thrombectomy first versus 33% in the stent first. So clearly there is some evidence that we should take out the distal clot and then do the carotid artery stenting in these patients. So what we can say in patients with TIA and minor stroke, we should do stenting or endarterectomy very soon, within first 2 weeks for sure, maybe within first few days. If there's a large infarct or a floating clot, then one can wait. In acute stroke, that means with the traditional in tandem occlusion, probably distal first policy may be better than the proximal first. Many of these patients need stenting in the acute settings, and as I mentioned, antiplatelet regimen varies within the various groups. Thank you.